many of you have gone through this situation, but we did it, and I'll tell you how we did it in a bit, and I'm sure you've successfully done it as well. Transport, we reduced the capacity, we had additional transport to be hired, and we need to sanitize after each trip. The workspace, we reduced the headcount in the offices, increased the workspace. Staff were working from different locations. We're a bit lucky. We have two offices actually in Dubai, and spread people around to ensure that we are meeting the requirements. Some people worked from home, etc. But at the end of the day, we had to think all this very quickly in order for us to mobilize this contract in particular. We talked about remote access for employees. We looked at readiness for them. And we looked at prevention and containment strategy to ensure that we had a proper business continuity plan. So how we did it? Country in lockdown, we looked at doing flyers, especially in social media postings, walk-in interviews, for then we couldn't do this, and then we started doing Zoom interviews and MS Teams. With no overseas recruitment, we actually contacted our competitors. So we did like 5 calls. We were a bit lucky that they were laying off some people. So we took people from a lot of big companies, which we were lucky to take them on board. So that, listen, I have to release 30 people. Do you have a place to absorb them? Yeah, please send them, you know. So we ended up getting good staff, and we overcome the biggest issue, which was actually finding good staff in the market. Then electronic online transaction at the GDF RFA. Our partners, we worked with them very closely and they helped us. Medical tests, we started doing tests in every emirate. I think at that time the easiest was Ajman. The accommodation, we obviously rented more rooms, isolation rooms were transport. We just had to hire more trucks, buses, and we changed the shifts in a way to make it cost effective. Because one of the things that we didn't want to do for this customer as well as existing customers, to tell them we needed more money. Because, you know, I'm sure transportation was costing you more money, accommodation was costing more money, sanitization was costing more money, PPEs, etc. On this, but again, we were lucky because of our spread around the UAE, we already were used to working on teams. We utilize a software called Trello. This is for agile management, and it's very, very good tool for you to manage your daily operations. And if you don't actually use it, I recommend that you use it, and it's for free. Increased workplace, staff, we spread people around meeting rooms, around different branches, and work from home. Obviously, that was the easiest, but I'm sure all of you had the Teams meeting at the beginning where when you open the camera and somebody is sitting in his undershirt and having a shisha and all these things. So we had this, and I had to go Google etiquette of online meetings. And then I send it to my team on WhatsApp. By magic, next day we had a Teams meeting. Everybody was in a shirt or a T-shirt. No smoking, all those things. No children in the background, no wife shouting at the guy. So we had all this, and I'm sure you all enjoyed that. And then business continuity, remote access for employees. We had to enhance the accessibility and increase security from online perspective. Specific staff identified for Ben team took a leading role in this, and I have to thank them for that. The PPE kits for staff, realign operational procedures, so we deferred some scheduled maintenance to and if everything which was non-essential at that period, we actually pushed it forward. I'm gonna just jump forward, I don't want to take too much of the time. But here, learning during pandemic, we thought that it is important to keep the training going on, but then we thought, how can we do it? So we said we need to do training, which should be safer and reduce the risk, and at the same time, we tried to increase the engagement during the pandemic with our staff through using online portals, which delivered results at the end. This is some examples of what we did during the pandemic. This is for actually a different contract than what I was talking about, but it was important that we had the people working 24/7. The training, rather than having 20 people, we were doing it at batches of 3 or 4. So social distancing is there. the personally, I'm always walking around the office, wear your mask, don't put it down. Fining, I actually have a jar box where everybody who doesn't wear a mask pays 25 dirhams. So at the end of each month, something with this money. I think we started with 500 dirhams. The guys now get it. So key learnings, we have a lot of challenges in mobilization and lines, a quality of staff that you need to have, meeting the client expectations and delay in mobilization, surpass the time, like what I did here. And when you do it right, you have some advantages. So you save time and cost, the reputation is built, okay, through having a good mobilization, downstream with your staff, with your suppliers, upstream with your client. So as they say, well begun is half done. And then you have project control, and that's very important. The bigger the project, the harder for you to have control on it. That's why you end up having more management staff on a project. But it's very important to always be in the driver's seat. And at the end, you will have low escalation. So if the customer is happy, you know, if I'm an FM, I don't want them to call the manager on site. So that's it. I hope I didn't talk too much. I think I need a sip of water. Thank you very much. And if there's any questions, I'm more than happy to answer. Thank you.
I hope you can hear me if my mic is on. I think it's on. Hymns for mobilization resonated with all of us. We resonated with the concepts that Mohammed talked about. What stood out for me was the fact that he talked about collaboration. For me, there's no business which can move forward without collaboration. We may be competitors, but we are in the same industry. We are fraternity, and we want to work together and improve and develop together. So the fact that he was able to call a few GMs and CEOs and talk about people they were letting off and take them on board to progress contracts, I really like that particular aspect. Now, it's time to move on to our first panel discussion. Before we do so, and while we get the panel set up, if you go to Slido, we have the first poll for this morning. So you will see a question there, a fairly simple one. We'd like to gather your opinion about this while we get set up. So no surprises there with the trend of the poll results. Now, let me also take the opportunity of, while we're getting set up, to talk about the next or the first panel topic, which is the elusive world of FM contracts. And Tariq and Mohammed have set the base nicely from interactive discussions. We have three panelists for the first panel discussion. Tariq and Mohammed, we've already heard about. The third panelist is Jennifer, consultant. She's an accomplished global management professional with offering over 20 years of experience. So if I may please invite Jennifer onto the stage and along with Tariq and Mohammed, please. Hi, Jennifer. Welcome back. Welcome back. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for making time this morning to join us for some interesting discussion.
Take this. I'm fine.
Okay. So we are here. Yep. We all mic'd up and ready to go. The first topic, which is the elusive world of FM. Tariq very nicely set out this morning.
Ladies first.
Jennifer, someone new to the FM industry or a lay person, if they want to understand about tendering for FM contracts, you know, could you just share some insights to start off with a basic question?
How long do we have?
Well, there's a timer which tells us that we want to cover a bit of top subjects during this 40 minutes.
No, I'm just very new at that stage. And had a handful of FM suppliers, all with captive work, from developers. So most of the FM was evolved through that. I think now, obviously, it's evolved quite a bit in terms of bringing on different of the bid. And the education is key in my mind.
Absolutely. Thank you. Short and sweet. Would you like to add to that, Mohammed?
FM contracts are complex in nature.
If you're taking over from an existing service provider, one of the requirements you're kind of contractually bound to and in your own interest is snagging and desnagging. So you don't have that luxury of even the 30, 60 days because you need to have a pre kind of team, if I may call it that, who have to go and do the snagging before the existing or the incumbent disappears. Interest and it's interest for the customer. How do you deal with that?
It depends on the size of the company. If you have a sizable company, you will have a separate mobilization team that ensures that they are carrying on the activities from project to project and they know it like the back of their hands. So you have that consistency going from a site to site. If you have a smaller team, you need to have an SOP which is clear and you need to have also some people that have done the exercise more than once and to provide them with the tools that cut down the time. Before, when 10 years ago, maybe more, we used to go take a camp and then go back to the office, type, copy paste, and then the file is too big and then you have to make the pick. Today, there's online tools, there's something which is ready that is integrated with your CAFAM, sometimes it's standalone, but at the end of the day, you have put the command, email it directly to the client and get it quicker. So the key thing is to have the right people, okay, doing the condition audit or the snagging, collaborating with your client, collaborating with the incumbent or the previous service provider. And again, I think the relationships between the companies in UAE are very good, very healthy. I've had experience where I took over from different service providers and went very smooth, very professional. But it is, you need to do things not realistic, but you need to educate him, work with him and tell him, listen, we cannot do everything at the same time. We have to do the, let's say, primary sites, you know, or front of house, or the critical area, critical equipment now, then we will do 1, 2, 3 so that we can finish in a week or two. And normally the snagging or the condition audit, so that's where it becomes critical for you to do it and pass it to the previous service provider to fix, or then to take approval from the client to get money for the repairs.
I could see your reaction. You kind of really.
I remembered I had an argument with Mohammed 10 years ago, exactly 11 years ago. I was the photos during the condition assessment. I still remember this discussion. I wanted to add to what Mohammed is saying. Yes, you have a, usually you should have a dedicated team to do the condition assessment. That can be deployed the letter of intent or letter of award, what I've mentioned. The challenge here, if you have a tight deadline, if the existing setting, and the challenge will be in the condition assessment of the SSM for the specialized services, which is an outsourced service, whether it's firefighting or fire alarm, BMS, etc. So ASAP, in order to do the condition assessment, if you want to follow the normal with the governance, want to follow the normal procurement process, it will take minimum 3 weeks. 3 weeks to appoint them and sign the contract and get them mobilized, it will be too late. Absolutely. This is the biggest challenge today if you have your own team. Doing it, anyway, it would depend on the, some contractors, some clients are very well organized. They award the contract 3 months before the expiry of the existing contract. Few, but it is increasing. You have to be fair. Now clients are more organized. We're seeing this sometimes even more than 3 months they are giving to the new service provider. Of course, when you're taking over from a site for a bigger headache.
Absolutely.
Because our friends in construction, there is a trend in the market that they do 98%. Of the projects and they leave. And those 2% will live with you for another 10 years as FM and you will get blamed for it for the rest of your life.
Thank you. And audience, we have two handsome gentlemen and one beautiful lady, all smiling and pleasant. So you have an opportunity to ask questions. And some of you have been quick on the ball and you already put some questions on Slido. Others, please feel free to do so as well. Let me pick one question now and address it to the panel. Mr. Anonymous or Ms. Anonymous asks, is the customer aware about the cost or budget of FM, or do they consider this as a hidden cost?
The scope of the service provider or not. I think sometimes for his tenancy agreement, it mentions that if it's a spare part below this, it is already that you can. So now it's a pricing exercise, so there's no need for you to waste your time on something like this. The BD team will have to be capped for
when you could actually be focusing on innovation and other things. So I totally agree with what Mohammed said.
And Tariq, in terms of similar process, you can add a few points, but I'll then request you to follow up with something. What are the good practices that you follow and would be happy to share with the audience in terms of how you approach a bid, selecting it, and then pricing it and pitching it?
In Ijada, we have target segments and target clients that we ensure that we are registered with them and our registration is up to date. And whenever they have a tender, we get invited to it. We are very, I'm not saying that it's a small segment, it's a large segment, but it's a specific type of clients. And whenever we receive an invitation, we go the process of bid, no bids, very similar to what Jen and Mohammed mentioned. And so the type of the tender, the timeline given, the capability, maybe some tenders have require specialties that we don't have or experience that we don't have. And based on that, we take a decision to participate. Because if you wish, our clients are pre-qualified by us. In most of the cases, we go with bidding. We are participating in the tender. And we follow the normal process of the, those are industry secrets. We don't have to share everything on the stage. I have a lot of competitors here.
I was trying to tease out some secrets.
So I was playing on the phone, but I know that
he's on his guard this morning.
I'd actually like to add something. One of biggest mistake that I've seen that operations team are not involved in the bidding process. Not even only the operations. The legal team is not involved. The commercial people are not involved. Soft services manager, QHSE. So when you receive
But what type of involvement of the operation?
The operation most important.
Involvement, what? Are they decision maker?
They are looking at the RFP. They are looking when they are doing the BD team, works closely with the operations team to actually have the right model tailored for the client, looks at the KPIs and SLAs, and they put their comments and questions, and then they are involved during the stage of the tendering and even the pricing that, listen, you're putting this price for a cleaner or for a technician or for whatever, and this is not realistic. We cannot deliver. We had a previous problem in XYZ. So their involvement is very important. But the idea is that when the RFP hits your table, especially if it's a big one, you need to involve everybody. If there is a bid bond or if there is a tender bond, your finance guy need to actually get on board and ensure that he can deliver the bid bond by the time you need to deliver, submit the response for the RFP. So that chain is a project management role which should be led by the business development director or manager or officer, depending on the size of the contract. And their input is extremely important, again, depending on the size. Sometimes it's a small project, $1 million, $2 million, you know, it's a small project. But when you go to 20, 30, 100 million, no, then it is a critical thing. And that's why you have in every company limits for every director, GM, CEO, et cetera.
Yeah. No, we don't want to make the process bureaucratic or slow. At the same time, it is in fact critical that when a tender is picked up, you have the right people looking at the right stuff. You want the finance team involved from a preparation of bid bond. We want them to share experience from previous contracts, learnings and costs, so that you price them in correctly. You want your legal and commercial team to look at the contract losses and conditions. And of course, you want to have some operations involvement so that we put together. But the question is time. Do tenders allow this amount of time for this kind of collaborative effort?
It is, what you have mentioned is important, but if you have a process, everything will go in parallel. Mm. When the contract, the RFP is received, the coordinator should know that immediately this value is so and so, require bid bond with this value, sent to finance. Legal review is very important. Absolutely. Why? Because it is your right to ask for amendments for the tender. It will be rejected. But you have to ask for it.
Very pessimistic, I always.
And don't make it as condition, because if you put it as conditional, you'll be disqualified. It will be as a request.
Correct.
Just to, at least we tried. At least keep trying. Gosh. Maybe somebody will listen one day. I want to go back to the point about the involvement of operation. If you leave the bid decision to operation, the contract will be overpriced. this is a fact. Operation wants to be comfortable. If you need 10 technicians, he will tell you 15. So you need to have the right people in BD that have the technical skills that can do the asset review and understand the site. They will do the site visit jointly. They will understand that, okay, operation gave me 10, but I think that this can be achieved by 8 or 6 or 7. So the feedback of operation is important as a feedback, not part of the decision. Getting them involved in the decision will inflate the price. You will not win any contract.
Thank you.
So, but if you have a strong BD team, you should be confident that BD team is capable of giving the right price. You don't also want the operation to suffer. A contract that require eight technicians, you give them two, and tell them, and you celebrate that I got you a new contract, but I cannot provide the service.
Can I just add something to that? And is the fact that, you know, we absolutely need a strong BD team, but I also think you need a strong operations team who has the confidence and the balls, basically.
It is mobilization, not operation.
No,
the mobilization, transferring the
bid. Let me finish. Is the fact that, you know, when they are doing a tender, that yes, okay, comfortably speaking, because we've been talking about this for years and years and years, is to say, right, normally I would say, okay, it's 15 technicians, but I know that I can deliver this in 10. They need to be part of that team and not this constant challenge between the two, and that's why there's always this bunny heads.
Or maybe have somebody in BD with this operational background.
Yes, to be able to challenge them, but also then to educate the operational team that, and their lessons learned in terms of doing things better, rather than BD always correcting them.
Okay. If I may add, it's a nice discussion. Actually, the key word is team.
Yes.
So when BD team is in a silo, and operations team is in another silo, and other departments are in silos, there is no company. There needs to be a team. So there needs the process that for bidding needs to involve everyone and needs to ensure that they have the right sign off and discussion. And when there is a technical discussion, you know, you need to go back to the basics. Did you do an FTE calculation, full-time equivalent? How did you calculate the manpower? How did you, the number of cleaners, number of technicians, etc. So there's a science behind it. And then, okay, there is a 10-15% that you can go up and down. But, you know, I am lucky enough to have a great operations director and to have a good, excellent also HR and the BD team, that all of them come from the same background, that they work very smoothly together. And when they end up debating something, it needs to go to somebody higher than them for a decision, and everybody says his case, and then a decision is taken. But at the end, they follow the process from A to Z, and when they do it again and again and again, it's not time consuming. It's actually very, very efficient.
Yeah, I think wonderful. I think it's a wonderful discussion. You know, normally in a 45-minute panel discussion, as you approach, you kind of, what more do we talk about? But looks like we can go on for another 45 minutes. But let's, given that we have under 2 minutes to close our session, I'm going to use a couple of questions from the audience to take some last thoughts from you, 30, 45 seconds each. So two questions are, how do you manage and control changes, additional works in FM contracts without affecting client relationship? Second, what learnings from FM can FM companies provide to the clients before tendering so that clients make informed decisions about their achieving sustainability goals? So a couple of thoughts each on these from you, Jennifer, and then Mohammed and Tariq.
So the first question was about, can you just...
So basically, how do you deal with changes and additional requirements and balance client relationship during the execution of a contract?
I think, yeah, and I think that, again, it comes back to project control in terms of managing that expectation right from the onset. So if there are, and that happens all the time, of course, so it's making sure that that's integrated somewhere in the contract,
yeah.
that's additional works.
Sure.
Yeah.
The second question was, how do you help clients achieve their sustainability goals? That's a long...
I think it really is making sure that they actually believe in what they're saying, as opposed to just a check in the box, to be fair. Yeah.
Thank you, Jennifer. Mohammed?
Building rapport with the customer is very important. As soon as that is there, and again, I said you need to do it during the mobilization, you have the trust. You have the trust, you become part of the team. You become part of the team, you can understand his needs, and tailor solutions during the tender and even post-tender, there will come many things that he needs extra that you can say, yeah, I can do it. I suggest this, I recommend that. And sometimes it's actually an upselling opportunity for the service provider. So you need to ensure that you understand his needs, listen to him, and then tailor a solution. And with regards to sustainability needs, again, the most important is the client is willing to pay for it. You have something that you have designed into the service and into your budget, but if he needs more than this, then you need to come and talk to him openly and discuss budgets and benefits, advantages, disadvantages for each item. But nothing is impossible as long as Absolutely. You know, have the right time, you have the right tools and the right funding to do it.
Thank you. Tariq?
Yes, I agree. Sustainability is a big subject, a big topic. We cannot discuss it in a few minutes.
Seconds.
But again, as Mohammed mentioned, you need to have alignment with the client about the sustainability goals. You should come with the client with some ideas, some suggestions, and see how are they interested in this. Are they interested, whether it require investment, changing of their operation model to a certain extent. And if they are interested and you have the right, it will be a partnership that can achieve a lot of goals that everybody today in the industry is striving to achieve.
Thank you very much. A round of applause to the panelists, please. I think that was very insightful, very helpful, and I'm sure we have lots more questions. Now we'll take a break. We have 30 minutes of networking opportunity to talk to each other before we get back to a further panel discussion. Thank you very much, Jennifer.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mohammed. Thank you, Tariq.
Thank you.
Thank you for all your insights.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Hello, Sheikh.
Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Oh. established in 2004, Ejada Asset Management Group is now moved into the UAE real estate landscape. Ejada is the region's first token connecting solutions provider, and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners with energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Commitment and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships. Established in 2004, Ijada Asset Management Group is now weaved into the UAE's real estate landscape. Ijada is the region's first total community solutions provider and is focused on creating success for its customers and partners through its energy, commitment, and dedication to deliver superior service and long-term relationships.
Coffee area. If I can request everyone to be back inside, please. We have our panelists here, and we'd like to get started. So it is nice to see the buzz and the conversation and the discussions going on during the coffee break. I think it has been a good start to the morning, thanks to our speakers and the panelists, and some wonderful organization by the ITP team. So we are up for another treat. We have a second topic for a good panel discussion, and we have some very, very interesting and experienced people as the panelists. So while we settle down, let me just briefly introduce the panelists. We have the one lady with us, Saima Ahmed, who is the Director of Human Resources at EFS Facility Services Group, and she brings over 17 years of HR experience with a strong background in developing core HR functions. Next, we have Mr. Marwan Othman, Executive Director, Human Capital Administration, IMDAD, an organization which we're all very familiar with. Then we have Prabhu Dharmarajan, Human Resources Director at Dalsco. And last but not least, I can call him my good friend, Jim Smith, because we worked together in a different organization for a long time together in our past life. So welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us on this panel. We're going to be talking about something very, very interesting. You know, most conferences talk about operations, technical matters, systems, and the like, but tend to forget the most important factor, And especially in our business, facility maintenance, I think it will unarguably be accepted that the biggest asset required to do this properly is nothing less than human capital. So we're going to talk about human capital, and first of two panel discussions on this. It is the importance of worker welfare. To start on a slightly controversial note, is this something we just pay lip service to? That pause is intentional to have dramatic effect. So let's get started with a few questions to just warm up our panel. And let me pull up. Again, I think just before we start off, we have a poll. Is there a lack of understanding when it comes to worker welfare among FM organizations? So akin to what I said, is this something we just pay lip service to, or do we really understand what worker welfare is? So please do answer. I'm answering the poll right now. And then we'll get started with the Q&A.
If I may.
Please.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Good morning, everyone. First, I'd like to say thank you for having me today. And inshallah, we'll try to contribute as much as possible in terms of giving the information that is required. It's a very important question, actually, when we ask, is there a misunderstanding of worker welfare? It's a yes and no. I believe that it is a yes. Unfortunately, many think that when we talk about the welfare of an individual or an employee, it only talks about the salary that is provided to him or the accommodation or so on and so forth. If you ask me, there is no limit to what initiatives that we can actually do to cover the welfare of an individual. Who are the individuals? Many people say workers. The first thing that we're talking about, I think, is ourselves. We are workers ourselves. Before we talk about others, we also need to talk about ourselves. We need to put ourselves in their shoes, the workers, so that we can understand. The welfare does not only cover the one part of it. It should cover, actually, the mental, physical, and emotional aspects of everything that is related to that individual. We list all these initiatives that we can do to cover these areas rather than focusing in one area. Health and safety, it's the job security, it's a list of things that we can put in, but it should not stop there. I think you can't only have one list that you can follow in regarding to welfare. It needs to be actually changing based on the needs of the individuals. Anyone else wants to add anything?
Thank you for that. Yes, please, Jim.
Yeah, hi. I totally agree with what's been said. We need to make sure that we look from the eyes of the employee, okay, because they're the guys that actually that we need to look after, make sure that they're content. There are a lot of people are working away from home, away from their families. There's a lot of mental stress with COVID last year, stopping leave. You know, a lot of people are affected. So we have to start by understanding really what the employee wants. Once we know that, then we can actually deliver and actually change things. So certain things that we actually take on board is making sure that we involve them in committees, involve them in part of the decision making, putting the carnivals in place, making sure that we engage them. And once we start listening to what they're looking for, we can then understand what we need to give them. And actually, you know, it's a given we've got to give them accommodation. It's a given we've got to look after safety, okay? So we actually try and consider them and involve them in all decision making. And once we do that, we're gonna get happier workforce, we're gonna get people engaged, and we're also gonna see staff retention levels increase and look after them, okay? They're our biggest assets. You don't not service your car, okay? So why wouldn't you actually look after people? So make sure if you're looking after something that's got value, look after your people, and you'll get greater loyalty, greater feedback, involvement, and they'll be part of the process.
Thank you, Jim. I'd just like to add something to what Marwan has said. I picked up a very important thing. Marwan, you said that worker welfare is not just about the physical well-being of the workers, but very importantly, the the psychological, so it's physiological and psychological, that absolutely resonates with me, because we live in a, Saima, if I can ask you, is welfare, worker welfare, different in the FM industry from other industries, and what's your view on that?
Definitely, FM industry is a people's industry, right? We can't go away. It is the product, the asset, the what are we selling in the market is our people. So worker welfare in an FM industry is a core which needs to start from the foundation of the organization, with the values, with setting up in the culture, with setting up in the policies and procedures, and ensuring that the Maslow hierarchies of need of a human being, which is our people, is met at all the levels of their hierarchy of needs. When we look at the hierarchy of needs, you have, as rightly said, the physiological needs, starting from the shelter, the water, the food, right, moving into their safety and security, whether it is about their job safeties, whether it is about their personal safety, whether it is in while they are in our staff accommodations, they are working at the work sites, so their safety and their security, their health is equally important. Moving further, the love and belonging, the engagement with their families, while their families are back home struggling for their living, they are here to earn their survivals for their families, how they get connected to them, how they get that engagement, that comfort while they are here, away from their loved ones, moving into their aspirations, their self-esteem, how they build that up while they are part of the organization, getting that development opportunities, getting that learning and development initiatives from the organization, where towards the end they can build up their career aspirations, they can see themselves growing and having their existence in this world.
Well, that's wonderful. Saima has actually touched on Maslow's hierarchy of needs.
Yes.
So I think it resonates with a lot of us. We start from our physical needs, our security needs, and our recognition, self-esteem needs.
That's what is about worker welfare. It's not only about the salaries they are getting on time.
Yeah.
It's
wonderful.
Much beyond that.
Yeah, that's wonderful, because I think that's a very holistic approach to welfare and worker management. Now, Prabhu, what would you like to add to that, please?
First of all, it's interesting to see that FM industry is bringing the worker welfare element
Absolutely.
Into it. You know, my viewpoint is worker welfare doesn't differentiate between the industry, because we're dealing with arms and legs, human body, the minds. What was the worker welfare 10 years back is dynamically changing year on year. A lot of emphasis has been given by Expo. Those who are working with Expo, they will understand how important worker welfare is given. For us to win a contract on the waste management side of the business, 50% weightage was given on the worker welfare. So that's the importance that the industry is moving towards. When we talk about our industry, you know, when it comes to labor-intensive organization, we deal with the human minds. And let me bring the current scenario. You know, we are looking into diversity. We have added a lot of different nationalities here. The worker welfare is also dynamically changing in terms of our approach towards the diversification. You know, predominantly this industry has been dominated by the South Asian sector. Right now we're bringing in a lot of African nationals here. So the mindset has to be dynamically shifting towards managing the different diversity here. That's where I see a gap, and that needs addressing.
Right. Now, I think you've touched on a very, very important part, which is the cultural aspect. So we work in a very multicultural environment with people, whether it's from the employers, the consultants, the contractors, or fellow colleagues and workers and employees, and of course the supply chain as well. So I have to touch on that. You know, what's your view, Marwan? How do you ensure that when you have people from different nationalities and cultures, how do you ensure that they are in sync and work well together?
I think this is a very important question.
Absolutely.
When we talk about the UAE or we talk about Dubai, we always hear that Dubai has approximately 200 nationalities living here. And it's part of the culture of an organization. It's like MDOT, for example. We have more than 33 nationalities in MDOT, and we ensure that we treat everybody exactly the same. And it's not about race, it's not about color, it's not about religion. It's about an employee or an individual working in an organization. Talking about welfare towards these individuals and these different nationalities, one of the most important parts or things that we need to do is employees' needs analysis. It's not about what we think they need. It's what they really need, and we need to identify what they need by doing certain analysis, certain questions. Part of the salary or the customer or employee satisfaction survey, certain questions can be added to understand their needs. Specific need analysis needs to be done so that we can identify the needs of individuals, whether it is from this nationality or that nationality. We, when we do announcements, sometimes we include different languages so that we ensure that the message is sent across, is received by almost everyone. It's not an easy thing to do, of course, definitely, having these many nationalities, but there are so many approaches or ways that we are doing so that we can ensure this. One of the most important part is that the entire culture of the organization is a culture of tolerance, where it accommodates all these nationalities and people from across the world.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you, Marwan. Jim, would you like to add to that, please?
Yeah, we've got quite a diverse workforce, which, you know, similar to the numbers of different nationalities. We also have a lot of blue-collar workers that live together very closely in camps. And we've got to understand their situation. We've got to understand, we also need to understand, they've got families that are worried about them, and they want to keep in contact. So giving them additional Wi-Fi, broadband speed, things like that, lots of little things like this make a big difference to an individual. To be able to contact their family, to be able to talk to their friends, try and meet their needs. We have limited capacity of camps. We have limited room space. We need to make sure people have got enough space to be able to live without being too crammed up together. Sometimes, you know, the bids that we put in, the tenders we put in, a lot of the time that, you know, the customer doesn't understand that side of it. But we need to do it because they're our workforce, they're our assets, and we need to make sure that they're looked after.
Absolutely. And Saima, when we were chatting earlier, you mentioned that your organization is present in 23 countries and with 18,000 strong workforce. Now, that's quite a lot by any standard. So I think you'll have a wealth of experience in dealing with people from different nationalities, culture. How do you bring them together?
Diversity is a need, and as well as your existence of your organization across 23 different countries makes it as to be embedded right from the core across where you see that probably today I am based out of UAE. When I go to Saudi, it's the same reflection of the values, the processes, the policies, the procedures, where you are not able to differentiate among whether we are geographically separated between the locations, but still it's the under the umbrella of the one organization. So diversity goes in hand along with the inclusion. Inclusion being keeping as a strategy of a people's organization, where you ensure that all the different engagement activities, the employee relations aspect, dealing with the diverse workforce is being taken care of at all the times, whether it is about onboarding people, the recruitment of workforce across the different countries, whether it is onboarding them and then being a part of the organization, going through the employee life cycle, equal opportunities at all different levels, rewards and recognition to all the different workforce who are really being, you know, putting their potentials in the organizations. Employees experience that aspect of it, it becomes the DNA of the organization.
Absolutely, absolutely. Prabhu, would you like to add more to that, please?
Yeah, when we talk about the diversity here, we should be very, very culturally sensitive. You know, for example, I'll give you a live examples. When we ask our Asian colleagues to do an extra hour, you know, they will be flexible to do it. Whereas if it is from a different country, say for example, African employees, they stick to the schedule. They will not be flexible to work extended hours. You know, they want to have their free time. The reaction to that from our team, who are managing them, they, you know, go hard with them. So we need to be very culturally sensitive, you know. So it is our, the organization's responsibility to educate our team who are managing the blue collar workforce. You know, how do we manage different cultures? You know, we are adding a lot of diversity here. UAE is also, you know, giving emphasis on certain visa discounts if you add certain nationalities. So they're promoting, you know, 16 countries, you know, where you get a visa discount. So when the country is working towards that, as an organization, we should also be adding value to the country by bringing in workforce from those countries. And as I said, it's important for us to develop the entire ecosystem to manage different diversity.
Right, thank you. So let's get into a bit into the nitty-gritty of things. Now, to start with, we need to provide good facilities to people. You know, when they have a long and hard working day in less than comfortable conditions, especially given the climatic conditions of the region that we live in, when they get home, or even it starts from when they leave place of work, the way they get transported, and when they get to where they live, the comfort, the environment, and the, you know, facilities to help them unwind and relax. How do you think we have sufficient monitoring systems in place that, one, these are in place, and two, an adequate level? How do you do that in your organization, and if you have any comments generally about the environment we are in? So who would like to start? Marwan again?
Yeah, okay. How do we monitor? We say there are a lot of policies and there are a lot of processes that are in place in order to ensure that welfare of employees are provided. And there are also, I'm looking at Mr. Saeed. Mr. Saeed here is our strategic director. One of the things that we always focus on is part of our strategy. There is a well-thought strategy related to people. When we talk about MDOT, our core values, it starts with people. People, service, and making a difference. So people come first. And when we build our strategy, we ensure that everything is actually set around that core value. There are so many ways that we do monitoring of the services or the well-being of the employees. We have, for example, Your Voice, an initiative that is established in MDOT to allow people to come and talk at any time that they want in terms of anything, the grievance policy, the HC Connect, and so many other things, as well as there's one thing that is called MDADI. MDADI is actually an approach or a way that allows individuals to connect directly with the group CEO. So it goes to him directly, it does not go through anyone. There is no filtering or anything. Whatever the message is, it goes directly to the group
and
CEO.
And how strong is your workforce?
Oh, very. So everything, open door policy. But one of the things that, how do I evaluate, for example? How do I evaluate what I'm doing is right or not? There are all these things internally. But sometimes you need an external factor or an external person to look at you and tell you whether you're doing good or not. And I'll take this opportunity to thank the Dubai government and the Taqdeer Award Management, where they have established an award system for companies that actually care about their employees, because part of Taqdeer Award is actually about the well-being of the individual. Alhamdulillah, MDOT participated 2 times and won the 5-star award 2 times in a row. We're proud of that, and this tells us also that we are doing good in this area, but it doesn't stop there. Like I said earlier, there is no list that you follow. This list will get updated every year. You have more nationalities, there are more needs, more requirements, and this is a continuous improvement, and we hope that we do our best.
Congratulations, I think it's well deserved in terms of the recognition for the good work you're doing. Now, the practicality of it is that there's a cost to it. So, Jim, how do you strike a balance between the cost of what it takes to provide what is a good standard of facilities to the team?
Yeah, hi. Obviously, we have to work within our budget constraints. But we look at it and think we invest wisely and deliver the right type of service, okay? What the employees want. Not only the employees, we've got subcontractors that work with us and we want to make sure subcontractors follow the same standards that we follow. There's nothing worse than two workforces working on the same job and one team's getting nothing and the others getting everything. So we do open the customer service relationship surveys out to just our employees. So we're looking for feedback from them. And as I said earlier, we involve them at every level. So when we set up our strategy to try and manage it, we have internal teams. So there isn't a great external cost to the company, but there is enough budget set aside to make sure that people get what they want, that what the surveys say, to make sure that what they're looking for to make them happier. Okay, and we try and deliver on everything they're looking for. And with that, we do internal teams, we involve the right people, and we deliver, okay? And that's the only thing we can do. If we don't deliver, we're just not gonna get a happy workforce. And we're certainly not gonna get the, if we invest in people, okay, we're gonna get loyalty, and we're gonna get people that stay with us. Our retention stays, attrition levels are much more improved, so that's what we try and do. Yeah. You can't always put a value against it.
Thank you. I love this panel because they give me talking points to go on to the next topic. Each of them is so rich with input. So picking up on what Jim said there, Saima, he talked about, it's not only about giving good facilities to our own people on our own payroll, but applying the same standard to our subcontractors or, you know, where we source people from. Now, you again mentioned in our chat that of the 18,000, there is so many who are on your payroll and so many, a substantial number, not on your payroll. How do you enforce it on your subcontractors, service providers, that they follow the same standards you want to apply to your own people?
We need to first set standards for ourselves and implement it on the ground. Evaluate ourselves, look at the impact analysis of it, and then engage the subcontractors and show them the impact on their productivity along with the with how these benefits or probably the comforts what we give it to our people, what impact they are giving it back to the business. So setting the standards, ensuring that these standards are met by ourselves, because you have to walk the talk. You just can't, you know, impose it as the standards to the subcontractors and they say you have to do it. That journey has to be together. You need to engage them continuously, as well as the assessment is very much required. So continuous assessment, continuous introspection, as well as giving the coming back with the impact will definitely helps the subcontractors to have that engaging experience with us, as well as, you know, strengthening the business relationship with the organization.
Right, thank you. And Prabhu, your thoughts on this topic of about how do you kind of differentiate between your own people? I'm not sure if Dalsco, I guess it's all your own people, but when you look at the market outside, is there a differentiation in how people treat their own people and don't bother as much about subcontractors?
As you rightly said, you know, we don't have many subcontractors except for certain projects. So what we do is we have a pre-qualification audit before even we sign a contract. You know, whether they qualify on basic worker ethics, standards, is it compliant to Dalsco's philosophy? You know, it's our responsibility to check whether they are adhering to it, whether they are compliant. As simple as, you know, they're going to work in our premise, do they have insurance covered? You know, the obligation will come as a principal employer on us. How are we going to protect ourselves by ensuring that the adherence to the compliance standards are there? So that's our responsibility, and naturally comes as part of the worker welfare, whether they are housed well. If they're not housed well, we ask them to move to our premise where it is we maintain certain standards. So we ask them to move here. So there is a certain cost element to it. But we ensure that end of the day, when they're returning back to the accommodations, you know, they are treated well without any differentiation.
Thank you.
And you brought up the interesting topic on the cost. I would like to share some comments. There are many decision makers and the CEOs here. You know, they should not be seeing the worker welfare team as a cost center. It is as equal as a business center. You know, I've got certain evidences here. I've got printouts here to showcase that. Because we are always challenged. So what have you contributed to the business? Just one example of retention. He also mentioned about the importance on the attrition. How do we curtail the attrition? We have retained close to about 200 employees who were potentially leaving or exiting the business. And replacing that one resource is about 6,000. You know, so we have contributed to the business of 1.2 million. You know, so that's a value addition that we bring Absolutely. To the table. So, you know, my request, and which we also internally, we also always debate is, you know, we're not a cost center. We are business enhancers.
That's very, very interesting. Marwan, did you want to add something to that?
Yeah, I think you touched this point very importantly. And the colleagues also covered a lot of points related to it. And maybe I wanted to add something. Is well-being initiatives are cost? They are cost if they have no return. But if you think about it, what is the return? Anything that you spend, if it has a return, then it's no longer a cost, it's an investment. Mm. Because it's actually generating or giving you an input in terms of efficiency, in terms of productivity, in terms of, like we said, attrition, because every person leaves, you have to invest in terms of recruitment of new people. So it's really not a cost if it has returns, and we need to focus on the returns that are coming from these initiatives, highlight them, and do them, and eventually it will be a return for us.
Absolutely. I think that was very, very well put. It's not really to be seen as a cost, but as an investment which will for sure pay back a return if done properly. Now, the thing is, we touched on attrition as well. We all know that there is a bigger cost associated with attrition. You know, like you take care of people, and like we said at the outset, it's not just about paying them well, it's about taking care of them. So, Jim, since you've taken more efforts in terms of the holistic approach to people, have you seen an improvement in your attrition levels? And could you cite some examples of how people have stayed back, not just for how much they're paid, but how the company takes care of them holistically?
Yeah, the people have got different priorities in life, okay? So, as I said, different cultures, different backgrounds, they've got different priorities in life, okay? The biggest priority is, look, I want to get paid. Paid on time, every day, every month, 30th of the month is in their account. That keeps them relatively happy. But, however, they're always looking for something else. So this is why it's important to keep engaging with the employees to make sure that they've got a voice, okay? They've got a voice at the table, they've got a voice, they've got an access to every level of management, and they come up with fresh ideas. We ask mm-hmm. them to come up with not only innovative ideas in technical and housekeeping and our service support, but more in new fresh ideas of what we do. Now, through COVID, okay, we couldn't do the our carnival, which is highly successful each year, so we couldn't do that. So we thought outside the box. We've got the teams in and thought, let's do a lot of online activities. And it was a real good participation. We had, you know, even our training, delivering training. All these things have a differentiation to, do I leave or do I stay? Okay, lots of things make a difference. And that's where we've seen the increased attrition levels. So we've had 5,000 people through our training center. We've had 400,000 training hours. We're not stopping, even through the times of COVID, not stopping, we're keeping delivering, try and listen to the people. They still want this, finding these opportunities to where they can't do a great deal in the evenings. We engage the workforce and we got them to do, even to sign up to English classes and so on. So it was a good experience, okay? But it's important to listen, get them involved at every level, and be part of the process of delivering and also providing good quality way of life.
Absolutely. Absolutely right. In fact, whatever we do on the people front does contribute in a big way, and it kind of takes us to the next topic, which is being able to link it to productivity. In fact, one of our audience has asked the same question, how can you link employee well-being with productivity? So Prabhu, I've read your profile and you say that you challenge the business to see HR as a non-business function or someone who doesn't understand business, that you actually run a business and shown results for that. And you also said that you have statistics to show. So can I request you to give some specific examples of initiatives taken on the HR or the people well-being front and how they've paid back in terms of business improvement?
It's an interesting question, you know. Worker hygiene is an important aspect.
Mm-hmm.
What we have done by adding the welfare officer, we have got a dedicated welfare officers qualified into the psychology aspect of the workers. We studied to find out why the people visiting the clinic, you know, we have got our own clinic, so why the people are visiting frequently and why people are absenting themselves. So it was affecting our productivity. For us, daily utilization is very, very important because they bring in the revenue to the organization. They earn, the company also earns. We realized that they were not maintaining their nails properly, the toenails. You know, they were having ingrown toenail. Because of that, they were not able to walk. They were getting sick, and they were absenting themselves. It's a minor thing, but that cost us a certain percentage of productivity for us. What we did is we did a program on how to maintain personal hygiene. We added a new pair of socks. You know, so that helped us to reduce the productivity. We have been monitoring it for the last 5 years, how year on year it has been reducing. So small aspects like this, you know, we tend to ignore. You know, when our employees are representing the clients, maintaining the brand is very important. How do they maintain their hygiene? So as I said, these are the minor examples that helps us to add productivity to the organization. So when we get challenged, we need to counter challenge saying that, you know, what have we contributed to the business? How the welfare programs has reduced the accidents? How people who were having alcoholic, you know, so we have used forums where they give free sessions. Alcoholics Anonymous is a group that they go to different organizations, they give programs, there is no cost to it. We conduct health campaigns. There are a lot of medical service providers who will give, you know, come and do the medical health check for you. It's free of cost. So there is no cost element to it. You know, the company doesn't have to incur except for hiring the welfare officers and to pay their salaries, but remaining of all the things are free. We have pots in our camp. We ask the employees to go and paint the pot, to maintain the pot. Whenever they come in and go out, whenever they see the plants that they have been maintaining, it gives a cheer to them. We did kite exercise. You know, we did mandala painting. There is no cost to it. So when they bring out the creativity in themselves, they tend to be more productive. You know, they deviate from all the bad influences and, you know, they stay focused. So we emphasize on these aspects to it. So welfare for me is not the 8 hours of job. What do they do beyond the 8 hours is where the welfare emphasis comes.
All right, okay. But you know, let's also touch on a very, very relevant and practical aspect, comp and bens, you know, compensation benefits. There's so many different companies in the market, so many different employers in the market, so many different approaches. You have fixed manpower, fixed salary type contracts, moving to variable and variable, et cetera. So we have a mix of such things. So when it comes to ensuring that you're competitive in the market, at the same time have a lid on your costs, and also retain your talent, could each of you just give a couple of tips as to how you ensure that comp and bens remain competitive and that you're able to retain people? And any one or two specific initiatives that have helped you in the recent years to do that. Marwan, could I request you to start, please?
Comp and ben is always something that everybody wants to talk about. It's always the money. At MDOT, every 2 years, we do a salary survey so that we ensure where we stand in terms of market. The study itself through the agencies is one of the things that we do, but also we do it ourselves in terms of comparing with our competitors. Unfortunately, the competitors are not very transparent when it comes to this in the agencies, so they don't have that information, but there are always many ways of finding out certain information. We review our pay scale structures every 2 years and do the changes that are required so that we ensure that we are one of the companies that people would want to come to. But it's not only about the salary structure, it's about the other things that are also there that will encourage people to come. Some people might get the salary here, but not get certain things there. And this is, we see this a lot of times. He maybe is getting more salary here, but he will not go because of the other things that he's getting in this place. Someone said, maybe one of you guys can say who said this. Train your people so that they can leave, but treat them well so that they don't leave.
So here's a challenge. Who said that?
Who said that? Does anyone know? Who? Yes.
Richard Branson.
Yes.
A hand to the gentleman who answered that question.
Yes. So it's not only about the salary structure. My point here is not only about the salary structure. It's so many things. When we talk about Kanbanben, when we talk about welfare of an individual, it's not only one thing. You need to look at it at different aspects. So you either pay or you train or you provide these kind of services. At the end of the day, even if you pay, there's going to be someone that's going to pay more. And immediately people will go if it's only a certain amount more. But if you're treating them well, they are really happy, they'll stay, even if they get a little bit more somewhere else.
Thank you, Marwan. Saima, I feel like I'm neglecting you. I have to come back to you.
Yeah, sure.
I've looked up your career progression. You started as a recruitment executive and worked your way up to where you're director of HR. So what's been your journey in terms of understanding the psyche of your potential employees in terms of their expectation on to start with Kanbanben, they come on board, they stay a few years, what keeps them? What do you think actually keeps people in the organization?
I would say the recognition, the respect what they gain among with their colleagues, the culture is something which is very important for people to stick in the organization. It is not only about 9-to-5 jobs, it's beyond that. So most of our time is spent within the offices and more than the family what we leave back home. So that connect, that comfort, that respect, that opportunities, that commitment, what you get it from your employer keeps you going beyond your limits to come back and prove yourself and bring that impact to the organization. We are very proud to say that when the pandemic hit and the cost has been the main impact of all our businesses where they want to start not less than 15% to 35% of cost reductions in all the contracts. I think most of the business side of people can state yes, up to 35% of cost reductions in the projects. And the key of this cost budget is the people's cost, right? So how should we cope up with this? We proudly said that we had zero job redundancies. We were able to retain all our workforce. We tried to find out different verticals. We tried to give them the upskilling and reskilling opportunities where we utilized them at that point of time where the company was planning how to get rid of them. And today, when there is an opportunity, a lot of opportunities in the market and they are getting double the salaries, the technicians, you know, getting 30 to 40% of hike from all, most of my, fellow organizations, they are not leaving. So we still maintain the 98% retention in the organization, and I'm very proud to say that. So definitely there is much beyond the compensation when it comes to people, because it's all about people. Our business is all about people.
Yeah, no, absolutely right. In fact, what you said there about we are offering people from our fellow FM companies salaries which are 30, 40, 50% more, because we are all have all faced this resource crunch, especially in the last year and a half with visas and travel restrictions. And like I think one or both of Mohammed and Tariq said in the morning, we approach companies and try to source people from within the country. And that's led to a higher than normal level of attrition. And we are subject to KPIs and SLAs, and that's very expensive to lose people. So definitely there's more than Kanbanben. Congratulations, well done if you've maintained a 98% retention despite these challenges. So as we kind of come towards the end of the session, I'm going to turn to each of you to ask you a combination of two questions that come from the audience. People have asked, what mode of welfare activities can effectively bring employees closely with organizations or towards their goals? We've talked about it, but maybe there's something more specific. And then a more specific question, what are the three most efficient welfare activities? So maybe in each of your minds, if you have one or two top of mind initiatives which will keep people engaged and retain people, let's close with that. And again, let's start with Prabhu this time.
I'm of the opinion that employees should not come close to the organization. Organization should go to the employees. It should be a top-down approach.
Right.
To give cite some examples on the welfare activities, we ensure that our CEO has coffee with the supervisors and the workers. So we ensure that if there is any worker event, we invite the CEOs and the other leadership team to come and show their face. They don't get a chance to meet with them, and similarly, the employees do not get a chance to meet with the senior officials. So that's number one. Number two is mental health is very, very important.
Absolutely.
You know, we have had cases where, with the social media so active, if there's any boyfriend-girlfriend issues, you know, people tend to overly react off late. That's what we have seen. So how do we have the mental interventions, ensuring that the employees are aware of the consequences of this? There's a cost element to the business as well. You know, if there's any hospitalization, insurance doesn't cover much of it. The organizations incur the expense. So one is a selfish reason also to cut down on these costs, more so to ensure that the employees are taken care. And as you rightly said, retention is very, very important. So how do we do skill upgradation program, how organizations are investing their time, their resources in ensuring that the skill development program is effective. You know, yes. The organization have to work towards it. That's my three
Thank you. Points. Thank you, Prabhu. And Saima?
There's nothing much different what Prabhu has said, but definitely Mr. Marwan stated initially about the physical and the mental well-being. That is something which is the key when it comes to physical, their comforts, when they go back home with a tired, you know, full day of tiredness, go back home, the comforts, what they get it. The as simple as that is the Wi-Fi facilities being given to them for free, makes them comfortable to talk to their families in the evening, keep getting connected, you know, at any point of time, makes them feel happy about Absolutely. It and satisfied. Mental well-being, the health awareness is very important because they go through physical as well as mental stress. Their families' problems are not going away from that at all when they are there at the site as well. So the physical as well as mental aspect of it, health, you are giving them the medical insurance. What type of coverage it is. The maximum number of today, if we look at the blue collar workforce, most of the cases what we are coming across is the heart problems, the cancer diseases. All these is expensive for them if they have to go and consult the doctors, right? So ensuring that these medical commitment is being made available to them, that there is there. We as an organization, when the COVID has hit, we ensure that every COVID patient has a life insurance associated to it, so that not only them, we are able to protect their families as well, because they are dependent on them. So more than coming back, more than a perks what they get it, these are the initiatives which keep people going along the organization.
Thank you, Saima. Jim, would you like to add to that, please?
I think one of the goals that we're trying to achieve is to be the employer of choice. And being if you're the employer of choice, you're doing something right. And the only way we're going to do things right is keep the door, our office doors open, keep it open to the employees to be able to talk to the right level, have totally confidential access if they've got something to voice. Because remember, a lot of these people from different cultures where they won't speak up, and they won't say what they really mean. Okay, so I think some of the key messages to try and be the employer of choice is to make sure we listen, make sure we deliver, okay, and make sure that we provide as best a service we can. We've got to remember these guys work 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, sometimes seven. They come back, what do they do? There's not a lot more to do than go to sleep, talk to the family, you know, and a bit of eating. So if we can help that to be a more comfortable journey for them, I think then we deliver a better practice and hopefully move towards that employer of choice, and we keep retention levels.
Thank you, Jim. Marwan, you get to have the last word.
Always being the last is always most difficult because most of the colleagues covered many of the areas that I was going to talk about anyway. But anyway, I have one more thing to add. And I will give a story. It's not a story. It's something that happened just before I joined the panel. When I was outside, I received a call from a staff who was a blue-collar worker. And he called me and he said, he was talking to me about opportunity, about his difficulties in terms of providing for his family. And he says, I want a better job and so on and so forth. And he was asking me how to do it. And there is a policy in IMDAD that is called WAC. WAC is want a change. And every individual in the organization is having the ability to apply for any job that is becoming vacant in IMDAD so that he can grow. Individuals join at a certain level, but they don't want to stay in that level forever. So WAC gives them that opportunity. Every job that becomes vacant in IMDAD is first published through this WAC so that those people can actually come and apply for it. And he told me, I love this company, I don't want to leave. Please help me, I want to get this job. I told him what is the required so that he can get it. Ambition is a very good thing. When people have this ambition, from the lowest, this means that they will grow. They will grow with you. We're happy that we have people that have been with us for the last 20 years. We're proud of this, that loyalty. People will stay. Again, the compensation and benefits is one part of it, of course, definitely. But that growth, that career path should be there in front of them so that they can see and they know that they are going to actually build a career in this organization, and this is how they will stay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's give a big round of applause to a fantastic set of panelists. Prabhu, Saima, Jim, and Marwan, thank you so very much for those insights. Thank you. Thank you, Jim.
Thanks.
Cheers. Cheers, Prabhu. We'll catch up again. Thank you so much. Now again, I already said it's a brilliant set of panelists, the first one, the second one. They give an easy segue into our next segment. So they finished off talking about the importance of career paths and helping people develop and grow within the organization, people staying for 20 years plus in the organization. So the next panel discussion is very much on this topic. Before we start the panel discussion, we have a poll. Which skills are more important? You'll find on Slido this question. So please answer the question, hard skills, soft skills, or a balance of both. So while you do that, let's invite the next set of panelists to the stage. So the topic is FM industry education and training. May I please invite to the stage Prakul Tiwari, Business Planning Manager, AG Facilities. Second, engineer Fahad Mohammed, director of Dubai and Northern Emirates Adib Group. Third, Stuart Harrison, CEO of Emerald. And last but not least, Uzair Bamji, assistant manager, HR training and development at Farnec. Welcome. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you for joining us, Stuart.
Hey,
how are you doing? Welcome. So let's all settle down for another interesting discussion. Please, gentlemen. Somebody's glasses. I'm sure they'll come and get it. So, gentlemen, we are here to discuss a pretty key topic, which is education and training. And like the previous set of panelists said, people have aspirations. People have aspirations for basic needs of shelter, warmth, and then security, then self-esteem. At the end of the day, the peak of the pyramid of the hierarchy of needs of any person is realizing their potential. I think we're all here on this world for arguably a short period of time. We all have huge amount of potential within us, but it's all about realizing that potential. So it's a very, very close topic to my heart because I am on a search myself to realize my own potential, and age is not a factor. You can start and continue doing that at any point of time. So let's get started to start with this topic. In terms of questions, what does this mean to you? Let me just start with the question: is development of people and how people develop within an organization. What does that mean to each of you in a very few sentences? Who can I start with? Can I start with you?
I think this happens to be the hot seat. The question start from where I was trying to avoid this thing, but I think I will go ahead. So in terms of development, personal development, how I would see it is, does your own purpose align with the purpose of your organization? And I think that alignment should be in place for you to really succeed at an individual level and also to be in line with what your organization expects from you. Saima had mentioned the term culture, and that's something that we at AG Facilities and as part of Algure, we firmly believe in that what is the culture of the organization, because at the end it's a culture which drives the entire organization forward. You may have the best strategy in place, you may have the best operation models in place, but somewhere if the culture is not aligning permeating down at all levels and it is not aligning with your strategy, you may have the best car, but you don't have the driver to drive the car forward. I think you only gonna meet with an accident. So that's where I would want to say that your own purpose, aligning that purpose with the culture and the strategy of the organization, I think that is essential to succeed in life.
Thank you.
Hello, can you hear me? Now, what's development is, again, I think so the previous panel discussed pretty much on retention, pretty much on how we have to keep the welfare, and you spoke about ambition. Now, to drive ambition, and you have to reach somewhere. So if the person has the ambition and he has to grow, obviously, as he mentioned, there has to be a culture in the organization that does allow that employee to grow over a period of time. So he has something to look forward, not that every 2 years I'm going to look at a change, but rather I'm going to grow in this organization. And it's up to us as industry leaders and companies to offer them that that facility to train them or give them that opportunity to develop themselves in educating them and creating awareness that they have to grow. So that's the first thing. Again, people are working, again, 12 hours a day, maybe 6 days, 7 days a week. It becomes very difficult for them to even think that I need to develop myself. Probably a technician who comes in as a basic technician, he needs to learn, and we need to give them the platform to learn and enhance his skill sets so he can move on to the next level. So that's what I honestly believe what development should be.
Thank you. Stuart?
I think I'll keep it short and sweet, because if you sat in this room, you're probably on a career trajectory anyway, and there's probably not a lot of point in me lecturing you on it. But I think in essence, it's person-centered. It's about the person wanting to develop and wanting to grow, and then you provide the environment for them to do that in. And as one of our colleagues from IMDAD said before, it's about putting things in place so that they can avail of training, making sure the progression is out there and available for them. I think, you know, that there's the Emerald guys sitting around the table, and including me, I think all of us joined as something else, and we were all promoted into these roles. I joined as a director, now I'm the CEO. If I look around that table, I think we've all had at least two job titles between us over the last 7 to 10 years. So I think 20% of all the people in Emerald started as something differently. So it's just about providing an environment where somebody can achieve their ambitions and grow.
Thank you, Stuart. Jose?
For me personally, it's something I've actually built a career out of, 8 to 10 years. I've been dealing with training everyone from cleaners and technicians to our C-suite on a lot of different sort of topics, be it vocational, be it soft skills, be it leadership courses. So training means a lot to me, definitely on a personal level. Now on an organization level, as most of our colleagues have already mentioned, you know, it's a lot of it is aligning the talent with the organization, and then it's also finding the right talent to fit into the right place and giving them the opportunity or giving them the right pathway so that they can develop. I mean, we have cases in Pharnec where a cleaner is now an ICT assistant manager, which is something, you know, the guy came down from Africa and he had done his he had done a degree in networking, but he had come down as a cleaner, and now he's joined the ICT team after a little while as a cleaner. We had, I think, similar to what Mr. Marwan mentioned about the WAIC program, we have similar features over here at Pharnec where you can apply for internal technician. So not only that we allow growth in one stream, but I love finding talent where and matching talent to different parts of the organization, not just an upward stream, but even parallel streams. So
yeah,
interesting.
Thank you for that. It's very important, absolutely important in terms of training and development, but structure is equally important. I love what Marwan said about WAC, want to change, and people taking the initiative. Also agree with you, gentlemen, that development is actually comes from the individuals. They have to make more of an effort than even the organization. Having said that, I believe there's a responsibility with the organization to provide a structured career path. I'd like to ask you a hard question. What exactly do you have in your organization, each of your organizations, in terms of a structured career path where somebody joins the organization, regardless of the level, as a management trainee or mid-level or wherever, that at some point of time they're able to sit down with the HR team and talk about an individual development plan? I can go up laterally, horizontally, go up, but provided you pass these steps, you clear these things. This is what the organization will do for you, this is what you have to do. I'm keen to hear what you have in each of your organization. Who's raring to go first? Is there clearly a passion for you?
All right. So starting from the bottom level, one of the things that we have is called the Pharnec Career Center, where what we do is every year we run an assessment center for all our internal talent, be it cleaning, maintenance, security. It's a fairly comprehensive assessment center where we're not only assessing their technical skills or how well they've absorbed the basic vocational training, but then we look at their management skills, their computer skills, so on and so forth. And out of about 400-500 applicants per year, we pick usually the top 10, top 20. Last year for cleaning, we actually picked up about 70, and then we put them into a very structured program where we are delivering different sets of courses, different sets of activities, and working them through the level so that they move from a cleaner to a team leader to a supervisor, or in case of a technician, from an electrician or an AC technician into an MEP technician into a team leader into a supervisor. And very recently, one of the people in our program was actually moved up into an engineering role from a technician role at the expo. So that was one of the biggest successes of the program. On a staff level, again, we have IDPs, who are you, where do you want to go, for everyone. We have a biannual sit down with the manager, with the employee, where do they see themselves, what are the skills that are lacking, and how we can develop them. And you know, that's something that we're working on for everyone, your IDP, and then, but for generally for the larger, the blue collar staff, it's something that we can't, you know, and not every cleaner can become a supervisor, unfortunately, because there's just not enough roles available in the market. But it's the ones that who have the capacity to grow, the ones that have the willingness to grow, it's finding them out, making sure that we have a career path for them.
Thank you, Jose. Stuart, I mean, Jose touched on skills assessment and gap assessment and then developing a training program. I'm sure you have something like that in your organization. Could you talk about that, please?
We do, but again, it's a fairly well-trodden path. So I think we've probably all got quite similar things. I mean, we have something called a lead program, which we notice that the often the weakest link is the kind of blue-collar worker to management, that gap in between, and that's where a lot of things tend to fail. So we have a thing called a lead program, which helps people then become management. But something I'd like to mention is once you're in an organization, it's relatively easy, if you've got the momentum and the ambition, to progress, to be promoted. But it's getting that start in the first place. And I think if I asked, I think if I asked for hands of how many apprentice schemes that you run for school leavers, I think it's probably no hands would go up, I'm guessing. So what we're trying to do at the moment is we're trying to set up a proper accredited apprenticeship scheme for school leavers. Now this happens in more mature markets, happens in Europe, happens in America. Kids leave school at 16 or 18. They start as technicians or trainee engineers or whatever. It's not a graduate scheme because that comes later, but it's an apprenticeship scheme. And that's a very, very, again, in those more mature markets, a very well-trodden path to get young people from school.
Absolutely.
And bring them through into trades. Now, in certain countries, like, you know, I don't think any French or German people, but if you're an electrician in France or Germany, it's a very, very well-respected trade. I'm not saying we don't respect them, but I don't think they get the respect that they deserve, because it takes 4 or 5 years just to train to become an electrician, and then it takes probably 10 years to get the experience to be a good one. That's 15 years of your life that you've put into that trade, and I don't think it gives the proper, doesn't get the proper respect that it deserves here. So we're trying to put that into place. There are one or two companies in the region that do it. I won't mention them because I haven't got permission. But we're looking at what they do. We're trying to get accredited by people like City and Guilds or BTEC and people like that, and get those young people a start in life, because that's very, very difficult to do. Once you're in and you've got the ambition, it's not too hard to use all the things that are in the companies, but it's getting there in the first place.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Stuart. No, absolutely. I think taking people from institutes, colleges, universities, to bring people up from below and put them into the system so that they learn and grow with the organization is very important.
Well, it's again, if you've just left university and you've got a degree, you're already miles ahead. I'm talking about school leavers with no qualifications. Oh, well, they've got school qualifications, but they've got no work-related qualifications.
Hands-on experience.
Or experience. Mm-hmm. Try knocking on doors as one of those kids in the UAE and getting a job. It's very, very difficult. So that's something that needs attention.
Absolutely. Fahad, now, the subcontinent provides a lot of source for people in the FM industry here. Do you in your organization have any structured approach where you have some tie-ups with some institutes or similar in the subcontinent countries, where you identify set of people, have a curriculum set up, train them, and then bring them through your system? Could you share something on that, please?
Currently, we are working on it at the moment. Mm-hmm. So as a start, we have done a skill assessment program. So we'll be running it throughout, especially the blue-collar staff, trying to understand what exactly they know and how we can push them or give them that momentum to grow into the next team leaders or take up senior positions, and even assess them that even technically where they are weak. And something that I keenly work on and I'm a big advocate on is to try and develop soft skills. Because that's the way forward, because end of the day, if these ground staff are not ready to communicate to my customers properly, that's where I've got an issue. So that's where the senior management or the managers has to constantly go in for the meetings. So that's something that we have understood, and we have started working on that. We have started doing a skill assessment program to understand where do they stand in terms of soft skills, where do they stand in terms of hard skills, and develop them. And going back to your question, this is something that we are currently working on, and it's not, it would be out in the next couple of months.
Wonderful. I think it's extremely important for all of our organizations to bring people from the junior levels, where we can mold them into what we need them to develop into. Prakul, coming to you, one of the things that the panel talked about was the gap which exists quite so often between senior management, where you manage to get the right level of managers and even supervisors, but then there is a bigger gap. Suddenly there's a huge gap to the next level. So the problem is FNFM industry, across levels our people interact with the clients. You know, whether it's a person at the reception, whether it's a person cleaning the floor. There's interaction with clients. Now, a client has a question, he wants to ask the question, he looks around, sees a badge on the uniform and goes and asks the question. So you don't have the right level of people ability. So how do you address the problem of having this gap between levels to ensure that when, for whatever good reason, a person is not available, then the second person is able to step up and handle that situation?
I think I'll quote what Tarek had mentioned initially, that it's really not the manager, it's not really the staff who interact on a daily basis with maybe the tenants in a building, maybe the visitors in a mall, or maybe the CEO whose offices we are maintaining or cleaning. It's at the end your frontline employees who are interacting daily on a daily basis with these level of people. So somewhere the soft skills or the human skills really come into play, and that's wherein your hiring, recruitment, mobilization process has to be in place, wherein you you hire the right aptitude of people, which is easier said than done, because at times, as was spoken, mobilization can be as short as 10 days going up to 90 days, and then with all the challenges which the pandemic had imposed upon us, we really did not have a choice to recruit the kind of people we wanted. So the next best option was, okay, if you have the people, then we need to train them properly. And that's again where the importance of soft skills or human skills or people skills come into play. Do they have the right communication skills? Do they have the right aptitude? Do they have the right grooming to be able to at least, if not address what the end customer or the interim customer is expecting, at least they should be able to direct them to the concerned person, and that has to come both from sort of instilling a certain amount of confidence in your people to take ownership, to give them that empowerment that yes, they are responsible for whatever task has been delegated upon them. And they are owners of that particular line of business that they are operating in, and they should be able to at least address it to the best of their ability. And where they cannot, they are most welcome to reach out to their supervisors and to their supervisors and managers.
Yeah, no, you mentioned a very important point: ownership. How do you actually motivate or encourage people to take ownership for the situation? You know, like we've all heard of the management speak, like see it, own it, fix it type of things. But it's easier said than done. How do you bring that culture into the organization? Can I start with you, Stuart?
Well, again, I don't like business speak, or catchphrases, but empowerment is a big deal. If you make somebody feel part of a team and you empower them to make decisions, then they take ownership of it. You don't have to force that. So, and you can't force it. If you force somebody to take responsibility and ownership, the moment you turn your back, they'll drop it again. So, I've always found that when I was a junior engineer, if my boss had a conversation with me about what was going to happen, now of course he's the boss and he's going to steer me in the direction that things need to go, but he's going to let me make my own mistakes, let me make my own decisions, and then I feel like I own a project or I own the piece of work that I'm doing, whether it's a report, a project, a building a bridge, whatever it is. And I don't think it's any more complicated than that. Make someone feel valued, give them choices, make them feel ownership, and then they'll take responsibility.
Jose, would you want to add to that? How do you get people to take ownership?
I think it's something actually that comes within. You will find normally when you deploy a site or when a site is mobilized, certain people actually come up by themselves. There are people with natural leadership abilities, and in a situation once, because everyone goes through the same set of training, the same soft skills, the same hard skills, it's very important that you realize that at a very early stage who are the people who are taking ownership by themselves. And what we generally find is there's a lot of group mentality that happens with site staff. So it's very important to find leaders inside the group who are willing to take responsibility, or they just innately they will come up with their own they will take leadership of the situation by themselves. And there are leaders and there are followers. So I'm personally of the opinion that, you need to let everyone go through the same set of trainings and the same sort of soft skills training, hard skills training. Once mobilization happens, you quickly start to realize who are the people who are taking, who are the leaders and who are the followers. Once you can identify the leaders, then you can support them. You know, you support the leaders, you bring them up, and then, because they're the ones who want to take ownership. And let the follower, and then the followers will, just fall in line with them, and you'll very quickly adopt, and you'll very quickly be able to start producing results on site. Everyone here is an FM. Everyone knows the first few days of mobilization are always the toughest. Everyone is getting used to what they need to do and what they have to do, and you'll find very quick manpower changes in the start, and then over time it becomes very stable, and certain people start to outshine others, and they sort of come up. So yeah. I think it's very good to find who are natural leaders and let them shine, rather than forcing everyone to shine. So a slight difference of opinion here, but that's what I believe in.
So it's all about putting your finger on the right talent and uncapping the bottle. Fahad, you're smiling. You want to add something, I'm sure.
No, it's actually both the opinions are valid. I mean, obviously empowerment is key to get something out. So the person should feel that, yes, I have the ability to do certain mistakes, which I will learn. And the feeling that, yes, the organization is going to support me. I've got strong backup. I've got a strong leader behind me.
Right.
So I can go and make that change. That sets out the leadership in that person. Because, again, as he was saying, that if there are 10 people and one person has to come out being a leader, so he needs to feel that he's safe and secure, and he's got a strong backup at the back, and that's where the leadership comes in. So that makes a big difference for him to shine. And we as the leaders have to give them the opportunity to do that. So that makes a big difference.
Yeah, like they say, or I'm maybe coining it now, it takes good leaders to recognize good leaders. So hopefully we all are able to do that. Now, let's move on to a little more specific discussion. Technology, like with every industry, FM industry is also going through evolving technology and the use of technology to offer better services. At the same time, to become more cost-effective and also efficient in what we do. In this specific area, would you please share any initiatives or efforts that you're taking within your organizations to train your people to become more tech-savvy to use that in your business? Who would like to start? Yep, Jose.
All right, so way back, I think 2015, we as Farnec, we sort of changed our mission, vision, and we added the word technology into it. So that sort of led to a huge culture change for us. Even when we started recruiting, even when you're recruiting a cleaner, one of the things that we were evaluating is that, okay, do you have a smartphone? Do you have an email? Do you use the email? Are you able to use your what are the apps that you're using on the smartphone? Are you able to use YouTube? We started integrating that bit as, okay, understanding that, okay, the cleaner is sort of technology friendly and will probably adapt further into whatever technology that we have available. That was recruitment. Then on the other side, we were trying to create technology that's very easy for people to use. We launched something called the Farnec Smartwatch, which we've sort of done a lot of documentary about. But for the workers to be able to use it was very simple. They just had to wear a watch and come to work, and they were very happy. They got a watch. Like, oh, okay, cool. The company gave me a watch. I can call from it. Oh, the watch can call. It's something that they're not exposed to. Okay, they can press a button and they can call their peers. They can call their manager over a watch. And that sort of, the watch technically what that did was it helped us manage our time and attendance. You wear the watch, you come to work, your time and attendance is marked. It allowed us to communicate with our workforce without having to use cell phones, because on certain commercial sites, the client doesn't want to see you wearing a watch. So with technology, it's very important that it should be user-friendly. We sit sometimes in the office and we're creating a lot of technology that you know, you download a mobile app, and then you know we've seen certain, you know, we've worked on certain CAFM systems where employees are downloading apps on their phone, and then they're struggling with it because it's not something that they're used to, and they're so data friendly. So, I mean, one of the new things that we're actually working on in terms of training specifically is our new training format is going to be very WhatsApp looking. So employees are very used to using WhatsApp, so our training will just be integrated within a software that looks very much like WhatsApp, so they're able to use it very. So yes, technology is very important, and if you don't use it, you will get left behind. Also, you know, technology is a huge selling point for clients. They want to see different things. It's a big advertisement that, okay, your company is doing this. This is what we have in terms of technology. So it's a whole different gamut that we're talking about here.
Thank you. Would any one of you like to add to that, Stuart?
Yeah, zero problems with our employees using technology. Anybody between the ages of 18 and 30 years old instantly adapts to that stuff. Biggest problem we've got is getting clients to adapt to technology. So there's a whole, I mean, we're actually way, way behind in terms of our industry. I mean, if you look at just take some stuff from the gaming market, that technology is already out there. People are talking about AI, VR, all these kind of things. It's already out there. It's already being used by other industries. Even things like, connecting things like CAFM, BIM models, BMS, all that kind of stuff. We're still not doing that. And that's really, really fundamental technology. So my guys, I get them in. I mean, I've worked all over the world. I'm walking through a jungle in Panama, covered, you know, flies, snake infested hellhole, and I'll bump into people using a smartphone. So there's no problem at all with I guess for old people like me, it's harder to adapt. But for young people that are coming into our industry, no issues at all. Give my guys a bit of technology, they'll jump on it, they'll pick it up. You know, as soon as you give them an iPhone or a watch is a good idea, something like that, no problems. But getting the client to engage with it, because often there's a cost to it, and there might be an initial cost to get it set up and running, it'll give you long-term benefits. But unless it's free, unless it's value add or anything like that, and they don't want to engage with it. So the technology's all out there. It's just finding an application and then getting people to buy into it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we're dealing with the Gen Z, and clearly they're clued on, and it's up to us to make use of it for their development as well as the organization. Fahad?
True. I mean, I think so. It's key that in this day and age, we have to stick with the technology. What's the latest technology that's available in the market? But we always need to have a very clear vision and an objective. So that's again one flip side of the technology. We get sold. A lot of salesmen knock on your door with amazing looking presentations, with amazing looking technology, and you invest a lot of money into it, and then you realize that it's not even 5% off use to you as a company. So that's again to have a very clear mission and a vision and an objective set towards what technology we're going to use. And that it's not, I would say it should not be only with the leadership team, it should actually go down to the grassroots. You need to clearly educate or create a very strong awareness ground to your ground team that this is the technology we're getting on board, and this is the vision that we have, and this is the objective that we have to, as a team, achieve in order to ensure that we have at least touched 50% of that technology that we're going to buy and use, and how this is going to scale over a period of time. And obviously, the pandemic has, in a way, forced us to accelerate the usage of technology. Like for example, we used to have trainings in our training center, but eventually the ground staff started having health and safety trainings and other technical trainings on Zoom call. So they can be in their, probably not in the well-dressed attire. They can be relaxed in their camp and switch on the Wi-Fi and still go through that 1 hour session or 45 minute session, creating an awareness, which also marks as a training and development. So this is something that we have used technology as a boon, and obviously pandemic has forced us to adapt that. The youngsters are, as Stuart says, you give a smartphone and people can adapt to that easily. My four-year-old can operate an iPad much better than me, probably. So yes, this is the future. We really need to work on it and accept it.
Absolutely, absolutely. Prakul, a couple of words on technology before we move to.
There's something which I had read about called the iceberg of ignorance, wherein you have the top managers, the CXO level people who would probably know about 4% of the issues and the complications which an organization faces. But as you keep going down the iceberg, the frontline employees, they probably know 100% of whatever issues or solutions or opportunities that exist, mm-hmm. and that comes from what Stuart was saying, and what Bahad also resonated, that you really don't need to look at fancy presentations or go out of the market to understand what really is the requirement from A, your own employee level, and B, from your client level, because your front itself would come and tell you these are the things that we need to incorporate. The only challenge is how do you encourage your front lines to come to you? And I remember somebody talking about that we need to have an open door policy. So my doors may be open, but am I encouraging people to come to my open door? Mm-hmm. It's not just about me keeping my doors open or having not having a glass cabin in the office, but how do you encourage that frontline level employee to call me, to approach me? As Marwan had said, somebody had called him saying that this is, he wants to know about his career opportunity. So we need to be somewhere as leaders, be open enough and encourage those ideas to come to us, because that's where the ideas are, and we just need to tap onto them.
Absolutely. Now that's a nice close to the topic of technology, because technology should not be to the extent that you lose contact or touch with people. At the end of the day, we're a people-to-people business. Now, while we've been busy talking on the stage, our audience has been busy as well. They put up some very interesting questions. So we'll take a few minutes to go through the questions. So one question from Mohammed Irfan has actually got many likes from the audience. So we have to take this question. Don't worry, I'll read it out. So where did that go now? Mohammed Irfan's question disappeared from my screen. You were forcing me to look at the screen, Sheryl. So I think I need that. There you go. How's training effectiveness being monitored in your organizations? Please share your experience. So effectiveness of training, how do you monitor it, is the question. I'm looking at you, Fahad, so maybe.
Obviously, yes, training is definitely a big thing in the market. Everybody goes into training. You do deliver a one-hour presentation, or you deliver probably a half-day training session. And if your staff members or the people are not going to use it, then it's not productive. So typically we have to relook. So what we do is we try and relook at what are the materials that we are offering. Again, do not cramp them with a lot of information, but try and not take a material from outside and just deliver. Try and create bespoke training materials that is relevant to your organization, to your culture, to how your people understand, and try and evaluate them once it is done through its job performance. So training should be directly compared to the job performance. If that person, the skill set that we are delivering to that person, is it being put to use?
Right.
Is it helping the person to grow? That needs to be evaluated over a period of time.
Thank you. Now, Ozair, I know training's your passion, and from your profile, I read that you've trained over 15,000 individuals in various aspects. So how do you measure effectiveness of training?
So talking about a little bit about training theory, basically, if you're looking at effectiveness, you basically monitor three things. There's your KSAs, your null skills and abilities. So when we talk about effectiveness, we map or we try to measure all of these three things whenever. So first off, when they're in the training, you have to measure the knowledge. What is the knowledge uptake? So we always have, we start out with, it might be an MCQ quiz, it might be a sort of viva or a sort of talk with the employee to get an understanding of what they know before. It's like a pre-test or pre-evaluation. Then after the training, there's a post-evaluation where you're assessing the same things initially, getting the knowledge uptake. Okay, how much did they learn? After that, you know, it comes to your skills and abilities. These are things that we monitor on site. Once they've been deployed, we have a skills matrix that's available. We have a behavior. We have different competencies for map their behaviors. And then there's a standard rating. There's a standard understanding of what each behavior is and what if you're marking a person 1, 2, 3, 4, what does 1 mean, what does 2 mean, what does 3 mean, and so we get an understanding of, so everyone is on the same page. It is still a little bit on the interpretation, it's very subjective to each assessor of how the person is on site, but at least yes, we've had cases where the knowledge uptake has been very high, they've scored really well in the training center, they've gone on to site, they haven't done too well, but then we've also had cases where there was like a leadership change, the person changed, the supervisor changed or the manager changed, and that guy's ability ratings turned from maybe 2 to a 5 all of a sudden just because the person. So it's subjective there, but that, I mean, everyone has their own way to do it, but that's the way we are doing it. There might be better ways out there, but this is what we sort of figured out so far. We're always learning and growing, so.
Thank you, Zain. I'll move to the next question, and Stuart, if I can request you to take this first. Question from Shakil Ahmed. He asked, one of the gaps as a general issue in our industry is mentorship, availability of trained mentors and an employee mentorship program. How can we cover this gap is what he asks.
You can simply put it in place. It's very easy. One of the, I was thinking about it earlier when you were talking about, because there's, I know I'm waffling here, but we could spend all day talking about this kind of stuff. And I was thinking earlier about which were the great points to make. And I was talking about my team. So I've worked with one of the ladies in our work winning team now for 7 years. And she's now a chartered engineer, chartered through RICS, which is a very, very reputable organization. And I was her mentor. We've got a pool of mentors within our business. We just did an opening for our lead program that's happening again this year. And there's a whole list of people that are mentors. And surprisingly, not everyone chooses the CEO. You know, they look at the mentors, you might be tempted to because you think, well, maybe it'll get me a good promotion. But that doesn't happen. What they do is they choose the person that is most relevant to them. So you just put that out there and then, give people a brief and talk to them about what being a mentor or a mentee is and how a mentor will work. And they come and go for it. So it's, I think if you just give them the opportunity. I've got an external mentor. In fact, I've got two. And I went and looked for them. And they very graciously agreed to be my mentors. So I think, there's kind of 50-50 from the employee side, but if you also make it available, they'll use that service.
Absolutely. Now, I've personally benefited from mentorship quite a bit, and you have mentors during phases of your career, but I do have a mentor for life from someone that I've worked for 10 years. So thank you for that. Any kind of points you want to make on this, or should I move on to the next question, the rest of you? So let's move to the next question. One is, how do you manage to get the time to provide training, given the busy schedule of operations and bridging the gap of relievers? Prakul, would you like to take this?
I think this happens to be one of the biggest challenges because most of our employees work close to around 12 hours, and after 12 hours of working, maybe 6 days a week, the last thing you would want him is to come on his weekly off for an additional round of training. So somewhere we need to, there has to be a humane approach to providing training, and you cannot expect them that they, one day that they get to rest, you would want them and then attend classroom sections. So that's wherein I think this is something which we realize, and also somewhere pandemics helped us in changing the way we impart training. What we explored was the option of gamifying training, making it much more interactive. There was a movie which came, which was, I think, Bandersnatch, which was an interactive movie where you choose the outcome of the movie depending upon the questions which keep coming up. So you decide how the movie goes. So similarly, we approached a similar concept in our training wherein people can actually interact, immerse themselves into a VR setup. Mm-hmm. And then they choose which way the training heads. And every time they go wrong, they have to start back from scratch and then decide the right way forward. So if you can gamify it, if you can make it interesting for the worker, I think he himself will find time to delve upon it. And this is where he will also be able to understand concepts much better rather than just simply sitting, getting a group of people into a room and then giving them lectures. This is how if you make it interactive, you make it, if I know what is in it for me and I have an interest and I have a technology factor coming in, I think it's much more easy to understand and cultivate the training modules.
Thank you, Prakul. Now, with 5 minutes to go, let's get on to another interesting and important topic. We all believe in encouraging diversity in different ways in terms of people, where they come from, gender diversity, etc. But I specifically want to touch on the topic of providing increasing opportunities to people of determination. So we as an FM industry have office-based jobs, call centers, and people who have to deal with your CAFM and stuff like that, so which allows us to provide opportunities to people of determination. Not all jobs that we provide are on site or in difficult conditions for. So do you have any schemes within your organizations to encourage us to engage people of determination? And do you have any plans otherwise? And what are your views on this, Stuart?
This falls under the banner of equal opportunities.
Absolutely.
Regardless of whether you're a person of determination, regardless of where you're from. And it's just about removing barriers. So, I mean, I thought a little bit ironic when, because I knew we were going to touch on this subject and I struggled to get on the stage. So if I was a person of determination right now, would I feel that there's a barrier to me to talking on this stage? And the answer is yes, I would. I would be embarrassed because I might not be able to get up on the stage. So it's about removing those barriers. It's just about thinking a little bit harder and thinking about the things. You know, so if you come to my office, you'll see a ramp, but you'll see stairs. You know, if for example, you need to use a wheelchair, you can use the ramp. And it's like I said, it's just about removing those barriers. So regardless of whatever, you know, regardless of anything, you can still come and work for us if you want to, and there's nothing that will stop you. Obviously, you said there's some limitations. You just can't get past, you know, that's been decided by somebody else. But where we can, we remove those barriers, and it's really as simple as that.
Thank you. Any others would you like to add?
Just to add on to Stuart, I mean, obviously, we just need to understand as a community that obviously people of determination also have a purpose on this planet Earth. The same way we call ourselves that we have a purpose, they too have. And this is something that we have to create awareness among our fellow gentlemen, especially with the human resources should really put an emphasis on this. And what I look at them is typically is, yes, they may have, they're called people of determination because they have some extra skill. Probably this is what we need to look at or identify what is the speciality that they have and use those speciality towards our benefit for the organization. So this is what I look at, and that is where we have to create an awareness, probably even drill it down to our clients who would need to accept those sort of office-based jobs or how they can contribute towards our company and towards our the thing that we do as a service.
Thank you. So I think we come towards the end of this panel session. I'm going to ask the panelists one last question, thoughts.
Sorry, Prava, just while we're on PODs, for many of you who may or may not know, there's actually a center of determination, Sheikh Zayed Center of Determination, that's based out of Abu Dhabi. They are running workshops. We're actually working with them to create a workshop for FM. Mm-hmm. They already have a carpentry workshop. So they're working at getting skills for PODs and trying to integrate them into workforce. So just a bit of information if anyone's interested. It's called the Zayed Center of Determination. They are very interested in companies coming down and training PODs and seeing how they can get absorbed into the workforce. So
thank
just
you.
Wanted to add that.
That's very, very helpful, Ozair, and we will definitely contact you to get some more detail. Now, if each of you were to convey one message to the people in the audience, and also I'm sure it'll get back to the people in your organization, about your view on people in the organization, how you view them and what you're doing to benefit them, to benefit the organization. Last thoughts as a message, please. Prakul?
FM happens to be a people business. We are in, I would not say in the business of selling people, but I think we are in the business of managing people. And it's a completely I would say, a humane way of doing businesses right across all levels. And how well do you treat your people? How again, I'll go back to the culture and the purpose. How is the entire culture permeated across the organization, and is everybody aligned to the organization culture and the purpose that each one of them has? That determines the success of any organization.
Thank you, Prakul. Fahad?
As I said, I mean, as Praful even highlighted, obviously, FM is a people business. And if we look after our people, definitely they will look after us and our properties. We are built environment specialists, so-called. So it's end of the day, the built environment is looked after by these people, used by the people. So they need to feel that this is home, this built environment is what keeps us, gives us a shelter to probably live as our residential housing or as our office to work. So end of the day, caring for people is very, very important, and we should not lose focus as FM professionals in terms of looking after our people.
Thank you, Fahad. Stuart?
I guess, well, somebody mentioned it before on the panel, previous panel. One of the fundamentals out there is, you know, paying people on time. If you don't, hang your heads in shame. The other thing I always say to my guys is thank you. So when I took over as CEO, I pledged, and I think I managed it. I shook hands with everybody in our business. That was more than 7,000 people, and not in all in the same day. And I send a newsletter out every month, and I just say, guys, thanks. So you pay people on time, and you value them. And people generally don't ask for more than that. That's all they want, and opportunities when they come about. But so I think I interpreted or heard your question as, if I could say something that would get back to my guys, I think they hear it anyway. But just thanks, guys.
Here, here. Uzair.
I guess for me, the last word would probably be, if we were talking about training, then, you know, just please keep investing. If there's any operation, guys, please stop. You know, if there was a question earlier, like, you know, how do you find time to train people when they're on operations? I mean, things are planned, they're mentioned in advance. You just plan properly so you can get your guys to go for training. That's very important. I mean, if a guy has gone missing for 4 hours a day or 5 hours a day, I'm sure, you know, that same guy goes on vacation and you manage, or the guy falls sick, you manage. But if the guy is fit and present, then you cannot manage. I mean, just operation guys, please let people go for training. Invest in yourself. Please get training yourself, try and develop, keep learning and keep growing. So that's it for me.
Thank you, Ozair. Let's give a big round of applause to the panelists. Ozair, Stuart, Fahad, and Prakul. I think people are clearly the most important thing that we have in our business. So as a few closing remarks while the gentlemen are still on the stage, I think we've had a wonderful session. We've run half an hour late. Hopefully it's been worth your while. And we won't keep you away from lunch, a well-earned, well-deserved lunch from here on. But I think we are still going to be around for the next half hour, 1 hour. So let's take the opportunity to talk to each other. A big thank you to the sponsors. A big thank you to our organizers, ITP, for bringing all the fraternity, the industry together. A big round of applause to ourselves, please. Thank you. Cheers. Cheers, Stuart. Lunch, gentlemen and ladies.